Good afternoon slash morning, everyone. Okay, very good. Looks like we have about 13 people who are on right now. Now 15, great. All right, so we will get started here momentarily. And I believe everyone who is joining as an attendee should be muted at this point in time. Cecilia, do you have a preference regarding questions? Would you like to take questions at the end of the webinar?
Yes, at the end, please.
Okay, perfect. Just a note for all the attendees. So you are welcome to submit questions via the chat box. There's an option to go into Q&A. And if you would like, you can certainly send in questions that way or through chatting. I will have that open through the duration of the webinar. So at the end of the webinar, what we'll do is if there are questions sent in through the chat, I will go ahead and present those to Cecilia to answer. All right, are we ready to get started? Cecilia, are you ready?
We're ready when you are. I didn't know if you wanted to give people another minute or if you think everyone has logged in.
I think we have about 17 people in, so we could go ahead and I think we have enough to get started here.
Okay, great.
All right, great. So I will go ahead and do an introduction briefly. My name is Chelsea Heyman. I'm the Director of Housing Policy and Programs for the Maryland Department of Disabilities. Thank you for joining the webinar today. We're going to have Ms. Cecilia Warren, who is our Policy Director for Emergency Preparedness. She will be presenting on emergency preparedness for property and case managers. So this will be a very informative session, I'm sure. And what we will do here is Cecilia will go through her presentation and her slides. You're welcome to send in questions through the webinar chat during the course of the presentation or through the Q&A. And at the end, I will go through those questions individually and Cecilia will go ahead and answer those for you. So without further ado, Cecilia, are you ready to take it away?
Yes, thank you, Chelsea.
You're welcome.
Welcome from the Maryland Department of Disabilities headquarters in Baltimore. This is Cecilia Warren. As Chelsea mentioned, I'm the Policy Director of Emergency Preparedness. On our training team today, it includes Chelsea Heyman and Diane Dressler and Kim McKay. Chelsea and Diane are with our housing team, and Kim is the Policy Director for Communications. I would like to thank all of them for making the arrangements for this webinar and also for providing support today with the technology and communications and ensuring that we get broadcasted into cyberspace. Today, we will be providing training on how to assist your clients in developing their own disaster plans. There is no one specific method for this task. Our role is to provide you with the resources and guidance to provide assistance to your clients. You have received some documents electronically. The largest document is titled Planning for People with Disabilities and Others with Access and Functional Needs. The acronym is DAFN, D-A-F-N. It's the DAFN toolkit. I want you to keep this for your resource library. This was created for planners and emergency managers. Although we won't be referring to it today, I wanted to provide it so that anyone who wishes to sort of dig deeper into this topic, or it will be useful if you have a particularly complex case. You will find that the DAFN toolkit is a comprehensive resource of many, many different topics and assets, pertaining to emergency management, response and recovery. The other document is actually a number of separate documents and forms that we combined into one file for our use today. And that's what we will be referring to in some of our slides. So I always like to start my lecture with a little bit of comic relief. And in this comic, I wanted to just point out that even the dogs here are getting some training in their disaster plan. And if this is what your disaster plan looks like, you're in the right place. We're going to get it all fixed up. So here we have an image that shows the cycle of emergency management. The first part is where we are today, which is preparedness. Response. I apologize. I've just been informed that we have a little text.
We are going to work on, but I just wanted to let you know that we are working on it.
Okay. So in the image of the cycle of emergency management, the first part is preparedness, which is what we are discussing today. The response is when an incident occurs. And response and recovery often happen at the same time, and they are both very resource-intensive processes. We start recovering planning before an incident even occurs in many cases, such as a known incident, such as a blizzard or a hurricane or something of that nature. In a presidentially declared disaster, so when a state receives a presidential declaration, we don't typically see federal assistance arriving until the recovery process starts. So this is why we're encouraged to be self-sufficient for a number of days prior to expecting help for a large disaster. Mitigation includes all of the actions that are taken to reduce the impact of a hazard. For example, automatic fire sprinklers won't prevent a fire, but they can certainly mitigate the spread and damage that a fire can cause. We'll be talking a little bit later about some of the actions that we consider mitigation that reduce hazards in the home. So children and adults with disabilities are two to four times more likely to be injured or die in a disaster, often due to lack of planning, accessibility, and accommodation. These are not due to specific medical conditions or diagnosis. Modern disasters cause a broad range of collateral problems for responders, communities, and victims. Training and preparedness are activities that we use as planning tools. This process is never closed. We must evolve and accommodate changes and developments and new bodies of knowledge. In order to improve outcomes for people with disabilities, we take this new body of knowledge and improve our planning and our protocols and services available. Assisting your clients with developing a disaster plan is an important step in ensuring they know what to do and where they can find resources prior to an incident. So I wanted to illustrate for you the impact of a multi-day incident. So even if it's a notice event where we know something is going to be occurring that will have broad impacts, but sometimes these are no notice events, such as gas leaks or explosions, fires, and sometimes even weather situations such as the derecho we had several years ago. A multi-day incident will impact your food and water pipeline or food and water resources, shelter, of course, medical and health services, essential government services and public safety. Even financial transactions and gas stations can be out of service if they don't have electricity to operate their machinery. Now, let's imagine an incident that goes on for several days, such as the derecho we had, or even Hurricane Isabel. It was not uncommon for urban communities to be without electricity for a week. Of course, sweltering heat, no air conditioning. A disaster of this size can also impact commercial businesses. Without electricity, fuel pumps can't operate, and point of service or point of sales devices can't accept credit cards, so ATMs can't dispense cash. The demand for food and water reaches a tipping point within days. In an event where there has been plenty of notice, oftentimes supplies can be depleted prior to the actual disaster. if, for example, when we know a blizzard is coming, you will often see like the road salt and water, cases of water and food supplies can be depleted. We have not even touched on what happens to public safety and other government services. The need for help quickly outpaces the resources available. Even with mutual aid agreements, the local jurisdiction can deplete all of its resources for a large incident. We often talk about resilience. Resilience is the ability to anticipate risk. It is built through all of the steps that you take before, during, and after an emergency or disaster to be safe and return to a pre-disaster status. Our goal is to help our clients build resilience. In the context of disasters, resilience represents the capacity of a community to return to normal operations after an incident. Resilience can be reinforced by thinking ahead about the chain of events that are likely to occur. So in thinking about that, we have to think in terms of what the unmet needs will be for disaster survivors. They may need to be rescued immediately. There could be food and water because supplies have been deleted or contaminated. Healthcare maintenance, and for example, we often find that in snowstorms and blizzards, we have people who need dialysis, getting their transportation to dialysis centers can be very problematic when the transportation providers are not operating due to road conditions. So this would fall under healthcare and maintenance. Transportation, paratransit often is one of the first services to be discontinued. When a storm is going to be arriving, they will stop services several hours in advance. Replacement of durable medical equipment and medication. So for your clients that receive home health care, if they're receiving home pharmacy services, nursing services, or perhaps oxygen, or they may be getting some type of durable medical equipment on a regular basis, they should always have some type of an arrangement, including a disaster plan with their home health care provider. That is a requirement for Medicare and Medicaid that be in place for people who are receiving those services. We are trying to help our clients be supported in the most integrated setting possible. There are also a number of other services or unmet needs that could exist for survivors. For example, they may need assistance with insurance claims. They may need to replace vital documents such as a government ID or birth certificates. They may require temporary shelter. There are many derivative impacts of disaster. For people with disabilities, the most common derivative impacts include poverty, homelessness, because their home has been destroyed and they don't have the resources or the finances to secure temporary shelter. They may deplete their savings due to the cost of evacuating. They may go to a temporary shelter or recovery center and have difficulty because accommodations haven't been granted or are not available in the course of applying for services. And you may wonder, well, how can that be? And I'll give you an example. So when we open a recovery service center, we need to ensure that people can communicate. We have to have proper translators, interpreters, assistive technology, and a service center that doesn't have that could possibly have survivors that then cannot participate in communicating regarding what their unmet needs are. So let's talk about the family disaster plan. It should include the steps one should take to be safe. Correction, this is not the family disaster plan, is it? Are we on family disaster? Okay, I apologize. We're on different computers here at Redwood Towers. The family disaster plan should include all of the steps one should take to be safe and return to a pre-disaster status. Disasters can be categorized into naturally occurring, technological or accidental, and man-made or intentional. So some examples of naturally occurring risks. We have a number of them. You think about most weather incidents such as tornadoes, blizzards, ice, earthquakes, even wildfires or brush fires or drought. So here we have a photo from a flood in Salisbury, Maryland. And there were a number of families who were temporarily displaced from this incident. There are a few other hazards in this category that are not uncommon in Maryland, and we should always take those into consideration, especially severe summer storms and hurricanes. So under the category of man-made or of human origin, we often think of incidents such as fire or arson, of course, vandalism or security breach, bomb threats. There's even labor disputes and civil disorder. Fire prevention and security are hazards that case managers and property managers alike must always maintain situational awareness of. Having conversations with tenants, clients, maintenance personnel, and other people on the property will help reinforce what should and should not be done. Some examples of a technological or unintentional hazards include power outages, failures of air conditioning or the HVAC system, interruptions to your fuel supply, telecom, so, you know, phone service or cell service being unavailable, even things like a gas leak or ransomware on a computer. So an example of this from this image is from a devastating gas leak explosion at some apartments a few years ago. And this particular disaster killed 7 residents and injured 30. It displaced 80 occupants. So we always need to keep in mind that these are truly hazards that not only need to be prepared for, but we try to mitigate and prevent. So before we start writing the actual disaster plan, we need to have a risk assessment. We need to identify the hazards that are most likely to occur in a particular geographic area. We don't plan for tsunamis here, but we do plan for floods, fires, hurricanes, ice, blizzards, and the like. And so how do we identify the hazards we should be planning for? Well, sometimes you have to do a little detective work. I've listed here some of the online sources that you can start with. Of course, data and statistics are always helpful because they've already been analyzed and sort of compressed and are available in a neat format for us to use to sort of make comparisons. But you can also go through old news reports. There may be local expertise, and every jurisdiction and the state publish a hazard mitigation plan. It's a very long document, but it basically summarizes the top 10 hazards for that area and what should be done to mitigate or prevent damage. So you can find these documents, the hazard mitigation plan, online. You can Google it. If it's not posted or you can't find it, you can call your local emergency management office and they should be able to provide it for you. So some additional online sources that we look into for local hazards include the weather, weather.com, into their archives. You can also use federal flood maps, which provide a great deal of historical data. And sometimes the local emergency management website also has some additional sources for hazard information. So in the document that you received electronically, I'd like you to please find the file that was for housing emergency prep. So this is the document where I combined several different documents into one file. And the first 3 pages comprise the family disaster plan. There are a number of templates online for creating family disaster plans. And just for the purpose of today's training, we'll be discussing this particular plan, which I believe I adopted from American Red Cross. The beauty of this plan is in its simplicity, and you can feel free to use it as you help others or make whatever modifications you feel are needed. This is a rather simple version, and you will find the more complex situation that an individual has, you may need to add additional categories. The question in the plan of action section, this will require you to have some knowledge about the property and the client's situation. For example, determining an escape route or a location to reunify a family in the event of an evacuation You will likely need to engage in a discussion with the client to determine what the client will be most comfortable with. Whether you use this plan or a different one, there are some elements that should be included. The plan should include a future date for review. It is common to review disaster plans annually at a minimum, and it is also wise to review the plan after a disaster to see if there were areas that could be improved. At the beginning of the school year, the minor children may be attending different schools and need to have that information updated. Always include a rally point or a meeting point should a family become separated during an evacuation. I've also listed on this slide some other areas that should be included in whatever family disaster plan you decide to use. When we talk about creating a kit, how the occupants can create sort of a disaster supply kit, again, there are a number of lists and infographics online to describe what should be in a disaster kit. I chose this one because it is straightforward and it does not include extraneous items. But I think we should add an additional category or additional information, and that is vital documents. Survivors need to have vital documents like birth certificates, social security cards, government issued ID. These things may be needed to apply for various benefits and help. Now, this infographic is on page 4 of your housing emergency prep folder. More detailed information is also available on pages 5 through 8 of that document. Page 5 may be useful for people who are unsure of what food is appropriate to store for emergencies. So it gives you more detail about the most appropriate types of non-perishable food and food that will give energy, food that does not need to be refrigerated. Page 6 includes a list of household items that should be available during a disaster. Again, these are just basic items. It is quite possible that your client may have additional needs. And so that's what we're going to consider in this next slide, the specific needs that a family or an individual may have. So we have a number of possibilities here. So we'll start with service animals or pets. Your client may have an emotional support animal or a service animal. And of course, that animal will have its own needs, whether it be for food, water, it could be for medication, and they may have additional type of requirements, such as if they wear a uniform or a harness. Dietary intolerance is often forgotten. That is even additional challenges towards planning for what food to have available. Whatever their unique needs are, it can be used to customize their kits. I want to note that for assistive technology, it is just as important to have the charging device of the assistive technology, or it may not be operable for the duration of the emergency. Maryland Department of Disabilities has assistive technology kits for all of our statewide shelters and also for the recovery centers. And these kits include a variety of assistive technology and charging stations, but we may not have the proper actual charger, as sometimes they are not compatible or intercompatible with different devices. Please note that I have also listed in this particular list tire sealant for wheelchair users. I think that's important that wheelchair users have what they need in case they get a flat. Mobility devices that have parts that may need to be frequently replaced, like cane tips, should also be considered. As we mentioned earlier, individuals who receive home health care should have a plan with their service provider so that they can receive extra supplies, batteries, or medication in advance of a known event, such a hurricane or blizzard. So let's talk a little bit about food. While we are on the topic of disasters and evacuation, think ahead about all of the circumstances a client will likely encounter. Disasters operate on their own timeline, and they are not going to yield to somebody's eating plan or meal schedule. Surprisingly, many disaster survivors don't realize that there may be no electricity, no microwave, no refrigerator or stovetop to use. Storing non-perishable food is one of the easiest preparedness steps one can take. I even know of an emergency manager in Northern Virginia who has taken to training some of their clients by having sort of like a cook-off or a cooking competition, but the cooking doesn't involve any cooking with the stove. It's like the most creative meal that someone can make with the canned goods in their pantry. Page 5 may be useful for people who are unsure of what food is appropriate to store for emergencies. A client that has dietary restrictions, food allergies, or medical conditions that require a meal schedule may need additional support. So I'm thinking that could possibly be someone with diabetes or someone with a specifically strong allergy such as to peanuts. Also, don't forget to include food for any household animals. And of course, infants and toddlers' nutrition needs should also be included. So communication, we talk about communication and how important it is to have accessible information. So let's move on and talk about warning systems. Emergency management agencies, both local and state, convey many important messages to the public in advance of a known disaster. Each county has an alert system that residents can register for and receive notifications for their geographic area. If you're not sure how to find this, you could Google, and I'm using this as an example, Alert Montgomery or Alert Baltimore, Alert Anne Arundel, and that should take you for the link. They all use the same company, but the links are separated by the name of the jurisdiction. And the resident can register to receive warnings by text or email. And it can provide very useful information. In addition to the traditional sources of warnings and advisories, such as TV and radio, many organizations also push out information through social media, which has become the conduit for updates in real time. After a disaster, clients should continue to follow updates for information on points of distribution, and that would include if we had to distribute a large amount of medicine or if the water supply was contaminated and we were distributing bottled water or even food. They would announce a point of distribution, and it's unlikely that it would just be in one location. It would be in many locations, and you'd want to get that information. Other types of updates and information that are important would be disaster recovery centers, their location and hours and what to bring, town hall meetings, and of course, other services. A disaster recovery center would bring together agencies throughout the state that provide services. So it would include like public health, human services, the insurance administration, all of the entities that may be able to assist you during your disaster recovery. So let's talk for a few minutes about the emergency information card. I have several types of numbers that should be included in the emergency information card. And we also have some examples in the emergency, preparedness file that was sent to you in advance. They should be on pages 11 and 15. And in addition to these numbers, I would suggest that if a client uses a home health care company, again, for prescriptions, nursing care, or durable medical equipment, that number should also be included. So for your convenience, we've included two examples or templates. I believe the first one also has some additional information included. And this should be kept perhaps with a brief summary of the clients, their meeting point or their area that they would reunify with their family. And of course, this may need to be updated more than once a year. So on slide 22, we have found that additional numbers are also helpful, although they are not required on the emergency contact information. These are helpful to have close by. You want your clients to be able to easily contact these services. And during a disaster, one, stress increases and executive functioning may diminish. So having important contact information readily available will be helpful. In addition to the entities listed, you may also wish to add contact information for organizations of value to that specific client, such as the relay service, their medical transport service, and the like. Please notice that on this list, we do have Maryland Human Services, and I believe I may have forgotten to add Maryland Public Health. So I just take that as a little verbal reminder. So how do we find our loved ones? What can you tell your clients about reunification post-disaster? There are a few resources here that they should be aware of. For large-scale disasters, families can become separated and have difficulty locating their loved ones. This process of reuniting people is called reunification. And some services have developed for free, such as Google's, and others are services that are free but only get stood up, if you will, post-disaster when needed. Reunifying families is important to disaster recovery. So this is why we want to keep these resources in mind. Google Person Finder is a web tool that Google stands up after a disaster. Keep in mind it is open to all and the content is not vetted. So it can't be determined whether it's accurate. It really depends on the person located in the disaster zone with having internet access and being able to update it. The Red Cross operates Safe and Well for survivors inside of a disaster area to register their status for loved ones. People who are located outside of the U.S. should always register with the State Department, even if they are residents, residents that are American citizens, that they're residing in another country, or if they're a student or traveling. This is how the State Department knows who may need to be evacuated, in the event of a disaster. And Maryland Human Services also maintains a family reunification hotline that they can rapidly deploy as needed at the request of another entity or during a disaster. Now, these are not services in which you're not going to be able to go in and randomly just find out how well or necessarily where your loved one is located, but the loved one who's in the disaster zone can post if they are safe and well, and it's a starting point. So let's move on and talk for a few minutes about some site considerations and property considerations for case and property managers. This infographic is a concise summary that includes what the occupants of a property should know about property-specific instructions. I borrowed this from a housing authority in a different state because it covers a number of important things for tenants to know. This is not the only way to do this type of infographic. This was just an example that suited our needs for today's training. Property and case managers should review certain information with your occupants, with your clients. Infographic should include contact information for after-hour situations. It should also include, as this does, sort of an assembly area for emergencies. You should include locations of fire extinguishers, automatic external defibrillators, AEDs, and pull stations. That would be like the fire alarm pulls. Evacuation instructions, and also what to do during a power outage. Do you have emergency lighting in your building's common space? Always identify emergency shutoff devices in the event of a disaster if they are located within an occupant's apartment. So this is a summary of what occupants should know. What are the escape routes from our home? What's the rally point or meeting place if we become separated during an emergency? Where are the fire extinguishers located? The AEDs and the pull stations, where are they? And how do they shut off gas and electricity to their unit during an emergency? For those who are interested in learning more about public access automatic external defibrillator programs or stop the bleed training. I have provided a link here. Something that you can consider for your own property if you don't currently have the program. Another good reference to have here is the Maryland Fire Codes. Keep in mind that each local jurisdiction will likely have additional fire codes that would be available either online or through their local fire marshal's office. But I do find that I refer to these codes frequently when we get asked questions about different modifications being made to a property for the purpose of accessibility. So these are just good to know links and where you can find that information. Emergency preparedness is not only about disasters. It can also include hazard reduction, also known as mitigation in the home. We urge you to review with your client some simple preventative steps that can reduce risk. Cooking and fire safety is really critical for all occupants of a building. Never leave food cooking on a stovetop and don't use aerosols around flammable vapors. Don't burn a candle unattended. These seem like very simple, easy to follow instructions, but it's shocking the number of fires that are caused by unattended open flame, or someone who goes to lay down, take a brief nap while they have food cooking on the stovetop. Homes with children should use passive measures to prevent injuries, such as baby gates, cabinet locks, and childproof lids. Heavy furniture or TVs should be strapped or use hardware to secure them from tipping. You maybe have been following a number of furniture purchased from IKEA. They have started issuing hardware to go with it so that people can attach the furniture like dressers and chest of drawers to the wall so that children don't have the furniture tip over on them while they're climbing. Of course, smoke detectors should be installed in all sleeping quarters. And please, if you have an occupant who is deaf or hard of hearing, please ensure that they have the proper smoke detector and device so that they can be notified if the alarm activates. So lastly, one of the things I wanted to mention here that people often forget is about having documents that are ready to go. Most households, including mine, have difficulty in containing and managing the vast amount of paper and documents that must be retained. Case managers can help clients by identifying what constitutes an important document that should be kept in a secure manner and easily retrieved if necessary. Now, this list is not comprehensive, but just includes the most common vital documents. I mention this because disaster survivors need some of these documents in order to apply for various disaster services. It is wise to make copies in case the document is destroyed in a disaster. So I'm going to just use this specifically that, for example, a birth certificate. When you go to apply for disaster recovery services, you most likely are going to need that, but you will not need to have an original. So, you know, they just need it demonstrated that the document exists. There is an understanding that a certified copy is not necessarily going to be available. It may have been destroyed in a disaster, but definitely make copies and keep them somewhere that you can either take it with you quickly or store it in a different site than your home. Some of the other documents not listed here, any type of adoption documents or guardianship, things like that would be important. And of course, power of attorney and living will. So I really want to thank all of you for being so attentive in your listening today. We have quite a team here and you feel free to reach out to any one of us. I hope that this has been helpful to you and we have time to take a few questions, if there are any. And what I'll have us do, if we receive a question online, Ms. McKay will read the question out and then I will be able to answer it. Okay, so far there are no questions.
Did you not see any questions in the chat? This is Chelsea.
Okay, great. All right then, well, this concludes our training for today. Please feel free to send any questions if you're more comfortable sending questions in by email, or of course you can give me a call. And if you need additional documents or, you know, anything to support your work with your clients that I can provide, we're happy to help. So on behalf of Diane and Chelsea and Kim and myself and Yale, thank you very much and have a great day.
Thank you.
How was that? Are we done?